Hello, brothers and sisters of the Briar. Professor Jeremiah here. And Trooper's here. You're waiting on a treat, aren't you? Okay. I donned my pith helmet. Put a little safari music on tonight. I read a story today that was pretty crazy. Of some poachers, rhino poachers. You're going to have to move your melon. Some rhino poachers in South Africa who were eaten by lions. Alive, the article said. Not a very nice way to go, is it? Started making me think of Africa. The dog now wants my horsetail here. You can't have a horse's tail. If you've ever seen this in African movies, this was to swish the flies away from you. Both of them scouts down here trying to get it too. This comes in handy in real life when you're living in the bush. This is one that I actually used on a regular basis when living in the village. Mostly when you'd go to visit people, you'd take this with you because you're going to sit around and there'll be a lot of flies and little gnats around. Something all the old men would carry. One of the old men that I knew always had it on a little button on his shirt. And each shirt that he had a little button for it. For his little fly swatter, a little fly chaser. I also wore a pith helmet for real. I know it's kind of nostalgic in a way, but it serves a real purpose. And a lot of missionaries today either don't wear them because of kind of the mindset that they would think, oh, it's kind of, you know, an old, you know, British thing or kind of old colonial dress. The people where I worked had no idea of it being related to colonialism, though it's functional. I started wearing it when I got my first migraine headaches in Africa. And they always came when I'd been working out in the sun. An African sun is very different from sun that you would get here. The African sun will just penetrate your clothes. I mean, when you get sunburned for the first time while you're wearing a long sleeve shirt and it's your arm under the shirt that burns, you know that you're in a different place. And so the original purpose was, this is cork. It's not synthetic material like the Marine Corps pith helmet or like some that you might see today, even plastic pith helmets. And the cork helps keep your head cool, and it's lifted up off your head. You have a vent holes up in the top, vent holes in the side. Another thing though, which you do with the pith helmet is you take it and dunk it in some water. And when you put it back on your head, it would act as a real cooling agent. And there's been a couple of times that it got my head so cool, I even would take it off for a minute and let it dry out, because it would just create such a cooling effect that you'd almost get too cold. The story which I read today was about some poachers in South Africa who were after rhinos, and they were attacked and killed by lions. The article went on to say that they had been eaten alive by lions. Not a nice way to go, is it? It reminded me of this book which I have here. Lion: African Adventures with the King of Beasts by Martin Johnson. Now, if you're not familiar with Osa and Martin Johnson, if you've ever seen any of the old Tarzan movies, Osa and Martin Johnson were really responsible for filming most of the wildlife scenes that you see in a lot of the older African wildlife movies. So whenever you would see Tarzan dealing with animals and then you don't see him, but you just see a rhino charging through the bush or wild elephants, in most cases that is filmed by Osa and Martin Johnson. They even have a museum, and I believe it's in Kansas. I should have looked that up, but it's, I believe it's in Kansas. You can easily look it up and see where it's located. They would at times travel back to the States and show some of their wildlife films around, and that's how they made some of their money until they started really selling them to Hollywood for movies. But in some of these stories that I have, you get a little bit more details of the story of the Lions of Tsavo, or Man-Eaters of Tsavo. The movie Ghost in the Darkness was made about these. If you ever saw the movie Ghost in the Darkness, you might remember one of the men's ripped out of his tent by the lion and drugged some distance from the camp where the lions then kill him. But the movie downplayed the real event because I think they thought that it would be unbelievable. And that is that in the real event, the man who's ripped out of his tent by the lion, he was the largest worker they had. He had killed a lion with his bare hands before. As he's pulled out of his tent, he grabs onto his footlocker. And the whole distance that the lion drags him, he is holding on to his footlocker the whole time. So when they find his dead body, his footlocker's there beside him. When I was in West Africa in the late 90s, it was a wildlife park that a lot of the expats went to. A lot of the missionaries would go there on break. And at that time, it was fairly affordable, really, for about $50, you could do a few days at the park going on safaris, and their safaris would be a truck with a load of people in it. But I came to befriend the guy who was a Welshman who was in charge of the anti-poacher patrol, some form of British service which he was there under at the time. And through knowing him, I came to find that a lot of the anti-poacher patrols, rifles and shotguns weren't functioning. And so I told him if he would like for me to take a look at them, I would, you know, be happy to. He wasn't super familiar with weapons at that time. And though I'm not a gunsmith, I had tinkered around with a lot of rifles and shotguns over the years. And so after dealing with some of the ones which he had, I believe they had a couple of 30 carbines. One of those wasn't working. They had two or three 03 Springfields, and they had a series of shotguns. And I was able to get all of them back in order with the exception of one shotgun. It was a double barrel, and I was able to get one barrel functioning. Probably could have gotten the second barrel functioning, but I didn't have the proper tools of really what I would need to do that, and the firing pin was what was all fouled up on it. Well, since I helped them out this way, the park, or the Welshman, offered to take me up in the park's paraglider, and I was able to make two trips in this paraglider. Really incredible. If you're not familiar with the paraglider, it has a parachute on the top, and it's basically like an ultralight as far as what you're sitting in. And so this is a two-person paraglider. I really wished at that time that I'd had a digital camera and been able to film some of the adventures that I had in that. But it was great because it was quiet in many ways. You could run the engine for a little while and then cut it off or not run it as hard so it wasn't as noisy. The baboons would see you and start barking and making all of their noises. I remember one time a mandrill, that's the baboon with the colored nose, saw us and started chasing us, came down out of his trees, chasing along the ground. We were probably about 200, 250 feet, not exactly sure what our altitude, but it around there. And man, he was mad. But on that first trip out, we started noticing the stench. Just thick death. And, you know, you think of smelling a dead animal on the ground, but the stench in the air was far worse than anything I've ever experienced on the ground. Well, of course, being in charge of the anti-poacher patrol, he needed to check this out. And it turned out that it was an elephant, which the poachers had killed. When we flew right over the top of it, it was absolutely unbearable. The stench just rose straight up in the air, it seemed. So, once back on the ground, and probably after lunch or something, we went out to check on the carcass and see what signs he could tell as far as what the poachers had been after. Of course, they were after the ivory, but most of the tusk that I saw in elephants there wasn't that large. But anyway, as we approached the elephant, I did notice it didn't smell near as much as bad on the ground as it had up in the air. And this was only a few hours later. The closer we got to it, though, the carcass started moving. And this elephant was definitely dead. As the carcass started moving, all of a sudden, here came all these warthogs running from the inside of the carcass. That was a real moment there. Now, we did have weapons with us at that time, but we didn't have to shoot any of them. But man, that was a wild sight to see, and just to realize that they had all been up inside the carcass eating it. On a second flight, we were able to locate the poachers' camp. Probably a good thing that they weren't there, because they might have shot at us if they were. But you can see their drying racks. We found a secondary camp that they had abandoned, or maybe they just didn't have anything on the drying rack at that time. Didn't see any tusk, but saw various animal skins that they had there. Their camp was right on the edge of the park. You know, it's kind of wild to have that experience and see things like that. There's not a lot of wildlife or a big game left in Nigeria. Most of it's been hunted out. One of the other wildlife parks on the other side of the country was almost void of any elephants. They hardly ever came around, and it was because the story was is that the local Air Force at one point had gone in and used the elephants as target practice. I'm sure it wasn't sanctioned by the official government, but somebody thought that that would be a good idea. So when that started, all the elephants went across the border into the neighboring country. So the Benin Wildlife Park on the other side was full of elephants, from what I heard. Smoking, Kendall Crane. Hadn't really smoked this, I don't believe, since my last video that I talked about it. And at that time, I remember in that video, I said, I wasn't really too sure about it. The kind of the charring light was really good, but I wouldn't have really raved about the smoke in general. But as I've sometimes pointed out, sometimes it's the pipe. And this is a Stefano. I don't really smoke this one that often. It's at the back of my rack and sitting with a number of other pipes of this similar shape. And oftentimes I draw one of those out to smoke. But this Kendall Cream is smoking great in this bowl. So, I always say, if you don't like a blend, try it at another pipe, or a couple of other pipes, before you just throw it out the door. So for now, I may have to make this pipe my Kendall Cream pipe. Well, brothers and sisters, and I will say, I have a lurker out there, just met you this weekend. Brothers and sisters, hope you have a good week, and God bless.